Morning all. We'll make a start. This is the sole person to give me a good morning back. That was nice. Thank you. Hey, for you, those that don't know me, my name's Sean and I'm the CE at Nutritech. My job today is to ensure you know what to do if something gets dangerous. So if we have a fire or anything that constitutes an emergency, we're going to meet in the car park. Toilets are through the back there, and we'll endeavour to do our best to keep you fed and watered throughout the day. It's pretty cool to be standing here today. I think I'll sort of stand here and reflect upon the last opportunity we had to do this, and it was probably 3 to 4 years ago. World's a pretty different place since last time we did this. So I guess if we consider the things that have happened in that time, it stopped us from bringing people out and having the ability to do this. So thank you very much for being here. Thank you for the people that are chiming in online at the moment. Guess we'll find out if the camera adds 5 kgs. 10 kgs. Yeah, if you can put a filter on to fix my hairline, that'd be cool too. And it'd be really, really good. We've got a few challenges. Yeah, don't laugh at too much, guys. You guys are going to be there soon. We're having a few challenges in terms of where we're going to be looking today. So we can, in terms of presenters, they're going to be staring down at their screens down here, which is going to make things a little bit tricky. But again, thank you to everyone that's here today. Thank you to the people that are chiming in. Thank you to our speakers that Nadine will introduce shortly. A huge thanks to those people that got here. And some of you may know there were some challenges with flights last night and even some challenges with some of the trips this morning. Conscious that some of you have driven a long, long way to get here. I know some people drove up from Palmy this morning, so they had a 3 o'clock get up. So get it. Nice work. Thank you for that. I suppose another part of my job today is to give you some insight into who we are, or a little bit further insight. For those of you that may or may not know, we've been around since 1915, so a little while. I know I might not look like I've been around that long, but I haven't. The business itself has changed many, many times throughout that time, but at the core of all of it is animal nutrition's been our game. Some of you that have been around a little bit longer would have remembered the Danish minerals. We certainly still come across bags out on farm at the moment that predate my time in the business. Probably of most note is some of the ownership changes that we've had in the business. The McNeil family owned Nutritech for 3 generations, so a pretty long time, right up until 2010, where there was a management buyout. The next big change was in 2016 when Lallemand took a minor ownership in the business, and I'll talk about Lallemand a little bit more in a minute. We have a pretty unique, I guess we call it a retention strategy within Nutritech. We have a scenario where a lot of the minor shareholders actually work within the business. So that still remains under the new ownership model. In 2022, Lallemand took a major shareholding in the business, which is pretty good news for us. Having the R&D backup, certainly the backup of a big business and the insight into future R&D is really important for a business that's located in the southern part of the world. We have manufacturing sites in Christchurch and in Auckland, which certainly has its benefits, having the ability to do both. And we've just updated the Christchurch factory to a point where it's the technology in that place is pretty cool. Animal nutrition and forage is our game. So that's what we do. We do the small inclusions that we believe give the big results. So that might be from a silage stack, where we're putting bacteria into that to optimise it, where it might be the other end of that scale may be trace minerals or amino acids, that sort of stuff. The things that require a lot of accuracy. We have a national sales and support team who are technically supported by a team of nutritionists. And I guess that's where we're a little bit different. We put a lot of credence on that technical knowledge. It's something that we believe sets us apart and something that we focus on a lot. The internal training, certainly for our field team is significant, and the tech team will tell you about that, because sometimes that's all they seem to be doing is training our people on the ground. We're not a big company in terms of headcount. We range between about 38 and 45, depending on the time of the year and who we've got in the factories. Anybody here know who Lallemand was? Yeah, the guy's down the back, that's cool. Yeah, the guy with the Lallemand thing on his shirt, that's good that he does, that's good. If you've drunken wine, if you've had beer, if you've eaten bread, you're probably already a customer. So Lallemand's core competency is yeast and bacteria. Animal nutrition is only one stream to the business. There are seven different streams, and I certainly won't pretend I know them all, but they range from coffee through to the wine business, through to brewing and the bakery. So animal nutrition is one of the fastest growing segments for Lallemand. And you'll see in a minute in terms of the R&D stuff that they do, it's pretty impressive. Interesting for a business that size, well over $2 billion in turnover, still privately owned. To the point where we had recently, after the local acquisition last year, we had the Jin Xiangyong came out, which is the head of the family that owns the business, which is pretty damn cool to have him come over and walk around our factories and, interestingly enough, go and kick bags and knew pretty much more about our business in 5 minutes of being in the place than some of the people that have been there a long time, which is really cool. 27 bacteria manufacturing plants globally. I reckon that number's probably light. I would suggest that there's probably more now. So they're of a very big scale. As the only techo or non-techo presenting today, I'm going to summarise this really, really quickly and tell you that there's a heck of a lot of R&D and a massive amount of investment in R&D that that Lallemand will do. In terms of a bit of a benchmark, 1/15 of Lallemand's employees are in R&D, which is a big number, particularly for a business of their size. 20-plus meetings participated in a year, and a heap of trials performed every year. So it's one of the cool things. I think we introduced a new bacteria strain to the forage market last year, which is the first time in 10 years that had happened. So some of the gains there are pretty significant, and they're certainly material. Anything you want to add to that, Nutritech team? That's good. That's pretty much it from me. Any questions, guys? Oh, that's good. You're quiet. Anyone want to sing a song? No? No? Good. I'll welcome the dean to the floor. Thanks, guys.
Yeah, hi, everyone. Just a quick run through from me on how we're going to run our session today. So, you forgot a slide, Sean. No, that's cool. I think we've done a fairly good description of the technical edge. I guess one of the key things for me is this traceability and transparency. So for us, around giving you confidence as farmers, veterinarians, nutritionists, that the products that we have, we test regularly, we keep retention samples, and if there's any issues, we can follow those up. That's probably the main point, isn't it, Sean, from that slide?
100%, mate. I guess, yep. What does that mean for you? Is it just surety that there are systems and processes in place? Part of some of those processes is we have to retain batch samples for 2 years. So you may have a problem 6 months later, we can pull that batch retention sample, go get that tested, and instantly get results. And there are a lot of processes in place. You'll understand probably as well as anybody that nutrition in New Zealand is not hugely regulated. And that's a challenge. That's a real challenge. We believe we're ahead. We're certainly ahead of the curve in terms of our accreditation process, because you have to be, right? Some of the stuff that we do is very, very accurate, and we have to have systems. It doesn't stop mistakes. What it does is means we can fix them really, really quickly. We can identify what's happened. And certainly our strategy around suppliers, that served us well during COVID. So it meant that our suppliers didn't walk away from us. They helped us out. And I can tell you, we've got some pretty cool sheds at the moment, because the supply chains are so congested and horrible over the last few years. So, yeah, we're
Thanks, Sean. So here's our agenda for today. So we've got a pretty impressive lineup of speakers, and we have to thank them for travelling as far as they have from around the world for us. And I'd love to say it's all for us, but actually they've presented two talks in Australia before coming here, and we thought, hey, let's bring them over the ditch and get that expertise here. So really excited for our lineup today. Just before we kick into our first speaker, Professor Greg Penner, I just thought I'd let you know, I see a few of you digging through your goodie bags, and hopefully we've managed to get one for each of you. You might have to fight each other for a few spares, but just in case you're wondering, we've got some of the mallow feed, which is the antioxidant, so if you're feeling like you're aging a little bit faster than you'd like to, then swipe this one from somebody if you haven't got one in your bag. You've got some Alka-Seltz, selenium-enriched yeast, another powerful antioxidant, so that's useful, and then some Levisalius B or our Saccharomyces boulardii, which is really good if you've got a bit of an upset tummy, travelling's giving you a few issues. Yeah, really, really helpful in that space. So in case you're wondering, that's what those are. I think there's also a sample of our silo-stop oxygen barrier for your silage stack. So that's what's there. So just one thing before we kick off is just managing some of the questions. So we've got 45 minutes for each speaker. If there's a question you have that relates to that slide and it's quite a quick question, then absolutely ask that as we go through. The speakers have said that's fine to throw a question as they go. If it's something that's going to take a bit more detail and time, we might reserve that for after their talk or for the panel discussion at the end. So we'll just try and manage those questions. We've got about 90 of you here, which is fantastic, but just want to make sure we stick to time, especially for our webinar guests who might be popping in and out. Of our talks. So without further ado, I'll just start with introducing Professor Greg Penner. So he is a professor in the Department of Animal and Poultry Science. He is a Centennial Enhancement Chair in Ruminant Nutritional Physiology at the University of, I better get this right, Saskatchewan?
Very close.
He's also got a Bachelor of Science and a Master of Science from there. And a PhD from the University of Alberta. He's published over 110 papers in peer-reviewed journals, which is pretty impressive. And his research focuses on forage utilisation, beef and dairy cattle nutrition, and regulation of gastrointestinal function in ruminants. And he will be talking today on biological challenges and transition in lactating dairy cows. So thank you.
Perfect. Thank you. Real pleasure to be here. First time in New Zealand, so I'm seeing a wonderful New Zealand winter, which is a lot different than a Canadian winter. Much more pleasant, that's for sure. So today I'm going to talk about some of the biological challenges, and I'm going to take a really narrow approach. I think you've probably all seen this type of presentation where we can look at a myriad of factors that affect transition dairy cattle. And so I'll just take you through it because it's going to centralize some of the thought process we have. So first of all, we know that as those cows are approaching parturition, we see a reduction in dry matter intake, and we're going to go into this a bit more. But at the same time, they're trying to promote mammary gland development to stimulate colostrogenesis and also to get them prepared and ready for lactation. Okay, so nutrient demands are going up at the same time as dry matter intake is going down. And so that puts pressure on the animal to maintain energy balance. And so one of the things that cows start doing is mobilizing adipose tissue reserves, increasing our non-esterified fatty acid. If we have over-conditioned cows that mobilize a lot, we might get into ketosis or fatty liver issues. Where I'm going to spend a bit of time is on immune suppression and what that means from a gut health perspective. But we know that that reduction in intake does compromise immune responsiveness. And we think that a lot of these other transition disorders, whether they be metritis, mastitis, maybe even hypocalcemia, is actually linked more in a negative direction, so immune suppression increasing risk for those other factors. And I think that's been highlighted if you look at some of the more recent reviews that have come out. Inflammation is really the core that is linking many of these metabolic factors or transition disorders. So I want this to be a bit interactive, okay? So I'm gonna ask you questions. I'm a professor at a university and I encourage my students to participate. It's also one way that I can make sure that I'm getting the message across. So what I wanna know is, or your perception of what factors during the transition period might be drivers for ruminal acidosis, which will be kind of the focus of this talk. So do we have any suggestions? Do you think rumen acidosis is a problem in early lactation? I'm seeing heads nod, yeah. What do you think might be some drivers for that?
Change in diet.
Change in diet, yeah. We have a change in diet and probably a big change in intake, right? Postpartum, we want those cows to rapidly increase dry matter intake. So fermentable substrate going into the rumen will be changing quite dramatically. What else?
Well, there's a hormone change in the cows as they reach parturition.
Yeah, social changes, endocrine changes, physiological changes that are occurring. So this is a list, and it's certainly non-exhaustive, But we definitely have abrupt dietary change, and that was brought up, and we have increasing dry matter intake postpartum. We have the social changes and maybe competition for feed. That's really from a intensive feeding management. I understand your competition for feed might be pasture allocation, right? So let's not get too caught up in the terminology, but let's look at some of the analogous situations. I'm going to point out some of the challenges with systemic inflammation, and remember, this is a normal process. Uterine involution is a process that requires inflammation. Okay, the onset and increase of milk production induces inflammation, mild inflammation. So inflammation cannot be prevented, but we need to consider when mild inflammation is positive and when exaggerated inflammation might be negative. And then I'm going to make a big case here on low dry matter intake prior to parturition, or the change in intake prior to parturition. So this is US data, so they're confined systems. And this would be based on ruminocentesis, looking at the prevalence rates for ruminal acidosis using pH as a threshold on its own. Okay, so if we look at this data, we see the prevalence rates range somewhere between 20 and 30% throughout lactation. And if we look at this data, we would probably make the argument that those cows later in lactation might have a greater prevalence or greater risk for ruminal acidosis. I just want you to be very cautious, and I think if you're going to look at implementing monitoring systems here in New Zealand, we need to be aware of those same issues. So this is a cow, 26 days in milk, 18 kilos of dry matter intake for this one cow on that day. We're in a single PMR feeding system, so you can argue we deal with some slug feeding in this model. And you can see corresponding to that feeding event, we see a pretty rapid reduction in dry matter intake, or sorry, pH. pH stays low for most of the day until it starts building. Okay, so if we use common thresholds for rumen acidosis, 5-8 is one of the thresholds some people choose to use. We might come in and, depending on the time of that sample, we might say that cow does or does not have rumen acidosis. Okay, but if we come the next day, and now this cow, because she's in just at the tail end of that transition phase, she decided to eat almost 20 kilos, and her mean pH is down to 5.6. So now it probably doesn't matter what time of the day we sample, we're going to identify that cow as being high risk for ruminal acidosis. Okay, so the point of this is not only do we see large changes in pH throughout the day, but we see large pH changes between cows on the same diet as they progress between days. So think about that from a feeding management perspective and how forage accessibility and changes in forage dry matter or supplementation in a parlor might affect kind of that characteristic change in ruminal pH. Okay, so if we do a more comprehensive job covering ruminal pH profiles, so these are cannulated cattle that had rumen pH sensors measuring pH continuously, granted only an N of 14, so I probably shouldn't be reporting percentages, but if we commit the cardinal sin, we can start seeing that our prevalence rates for low pH in early lactation are no longer 20 to 30%, they're more like 60 to 70%. Okay, so if we do a more comprehensive job, it starts telling a little different story where early lactation cows probably have very high risk for low pH. Again, this is confined feeding. The whole point is I'm showing you multiple studies that tell us the same thing. I'm really big on repeatability. If you can find something once, good. But if you can find it 2, 3, 10 times, now we can start saying that's real biology. Okay, this is work coming out of the University of Guelph. You can see the reduction in average pH after calving, and you can see the increase in the area that pH is below, in this case, 5.6, which is the threshold they choose to use. Okay, but the point is the same. These early lactation cows are at high risk for ruminal acidosis. Okay, so let's start digging into some of that, probably not just related to dry matter intake. So in this study, you can see dry matter intake in the blue-purple bars, And you can see dry matter intake increases all the way out to 60 days after calving. But the duration that pH is below 5.8 peaks, at least in this data set, around 17 days. So we can't blame all the changes in rumen pH risk based on dry matter intake, or we would expect these high intake cows to still have higher durations that pH is below 5.8. Okay, so this is the model we're gonna work with, and I'm really glad we have forage-based systems here in New Zealand. Okay, so we know there's a number of factors that are going to affect responses of those transition cows. Okay, so excess body condition score, those cows that come into calving with excess body condition have a greater decline in dry matter intake as parturition is approaching. Okay, so we get an abrupt reduction in dry matter intake prior to calving. That increases risk for metabolic disease. Cows that have infectious disease, whether they're coming in with subclinical mastitis, induce an intramammary inflammatory response, which causes a reduction in dry matter intake. Okay, heat stress conditions will cause a reduction in dry matter intake. I'm going to show you data that says this exposure to low dry matter intake increases risk for ruminal acidosis as those cattle start building their dry matter intake back. So they don't have rumen acidosis when intake is low, but as soon as they start eating more normal levels, they're at a higher risk of developing ruminal acidosis. Okay, we can see similar factors postpartum, so metabolic diseases. Hypocalcemia is a really good example, right? If they have milk fever, intakes are really low. These cattle go off feed. Okay, infectious disease, heat stress, same thing. And so if we drop that dry matter intake, and then as they recover, we start seeing high risk for ruminal acidosis. Okay, so I'm gonna make the case with data based on our experiments. This is a study I ran quite a few years ago, actually during my master's, and our cows did exactly what the nutritional requirements of dairy cattle textbook said they would do at that time. So they actually had a 30% reduction in dry matter intake as they approached parturition. And just like the data suggests, most of that happened in the last week prior to calving. Okay, so about 90% of that reduction is acute to the last week prior to calving. And then lo and behold, dry matter intake increases pretty rapidly postpartum. So exactly what we want to happen. I'm gonna get into it a little bit. What you can see here is a dashed line versus a solid line. When this study was run, we had the concept that we needed to steam cattle up prior to calving to adapt their rumen, adapt the microflora to try to stimulate better postpartum responses. Hopefully what you can see, and I don't have the stats up here, but I can tell you it was a statistical difference. These cattle that were steamed up prior to parturition had a greater reduction in dry matter intake postpartum. Okay, so we actually didn't improve the ruminal pH status using that prepartum steam up. Yep?
Sorry to interrupt. Just in the trawl, how many cattle were
it? Yeah, there's eight and eight on each treatment in this study. Right. Yep. So fairly small sample set, all cannulated. Okay, similar response. In this case, this is a diagrammatic characterization showing you what happens in terms of inflammatory responses. And really what I'm trying to do here is just cement the linkage between inflammation and dry matter intake. So we talk a lot about rumen fill regulating dry matter intake, or we might talk about metabolic factors driving dry matter intake. But the immune system is a very potent regulator of dry matter intake, and pro-inflammatory cytokines work on the hypothalamus to acutely reduce dry matter intake. So think back to when you get sick, the last thing you wanna do is go have a big meal, right? One of the things we do is reduce our nutrient intake during disease states. And you can see that here where as cows are approaching parturition, we see a general increase in inflammatory cytokines, and that corresponds very well to part of the reason for reduced dry matter intake around that parturition event. Okay, if you don't believe me, that is a direct effect. In this study, what they were doing was infusing an endotoxin from bacteria, IV, and looking at the responses for dry matter intake, some of the pro-inflammatory markers, so a pro-inflammatory cytokine and acute phase protein, and then non-esterified fatty acids, so energy balance indicator associated with that inflammatory challenge. So this is the point where they infuse that inflammatory challenge, and you can see over a 50% reduction in dry matter intake very acutely with that induction of inflammation. Okay, and that occurred with an increase in our inflammatory cytokines, so we can truly link it back, and increased NEFA and increased haptoglobin, which is our acute phase protein indicator in this case. So there is a very well-established and a clear linkage between inflammation and transient reductions in dry matter intake. So this brings us to ruminal acidosis, and I'm a very simple person, and so I think in simple ways. Okay, so if we're looking at pH balance in the rumen, we have two factors that are driving that balance, right? We have acid production on the one side, and this is really driven by feed intake and microbial composition, microbial activity. And then on the other side, we need to think of the factors that allow for the removal of the acid, okay? And we're going to talk about those in a bit more detail. So if our acid production is greater than our capability to remove those acids, we get into situations where ruminal pH will decline, okay? So these are the primary factors that relate back to acid removal. We have salivary buffer supply, right? That rumination, that chewing, that saliva that is contributed back into the rumen during eating events. We also have absorption of the short-chain fatty acids that are produced in the rumen, so the acid removal of the acid production. And then we also have passage of acids out of the rumen. Okay, and all three of these factors contribute to buffering that rumen environment. So I'm going to test your knowledge here. If we have three factors that are providing buffer into the rumen, by a show of hands, I want you to tell me which one is the greatest contributor. So those of you that say the diet, raise your hand. Okay. Those of you that say saliva, let's see a show of hands. Okay, so bulk majority are arguing saliva. What about rumen wall epithelial bicarbonate? So we only have Tony, but Tony's seen this before, so he's cheating. Okay? So Mike Allen wrote a review quite a few years ago now where he partitioned acid removal strategies from the rumen. And this was the calculation he made. He said that about 53% of the acid is absorbed or removed from the rumen through absorption. Okay? About 28% or almost 30% is removed via that bicarbonate that's coming from saliva, 15% from passage, and about 4% from other factors. And those other factors would be ammonia, ammonium, phosphate buffers, kind of the inherent buffering capacity that comes from some feed sources. Okay? So that's really important, and we'll get into the details behind this even more. But what I want you to recognize is when those microbes are fermenting feed in the rumen, not all of the acids are exposed to the rumen wall. And the only way those acids can be absorbed across the rumen wall is if they are actually exposed. So we can't negate the importance of rumen contractions and rumen motility, because it's really that equilibration driven by rumen motility that moves acids from the site of fermentation to being exposed to the rumen wall. Okay, so we have a lot of technologies that help us evaluate rumination activity. I think what they're really doing is providing an indication of rumen motility. And it's motility that we really want to promote. Okay, we're going to get a little bit into the weeds on methodology, so I just want you to understand what we're doing. An unfortunate reality of many of the experiments we conduct is I have to have terminal procedures in our experiments. So this is a study where we collected epithelial tissue from lambs. We kept it alive outside of the animal between two halves of an oocing chamber, And then this is our incubation system where we can create ex vivo, so outside of the animal conditions, and understand how that rumen epithelium works without all of the confounding effects that would happen if we were still inside the animal. Okay, so for example, we have our tissue sitting here. We have isolated sides that would face the rumen. We have an isolated side that would face the blood. And we can put in markers or tracers into one side. Over time, we can measure the appearance of that marker or that tracer on the other side. And so with the use of inhibitors and differing conditions, we can start gaining a lot of knowledge on how those nutrients move across that live tissue. Okay, so we're gonna go to Transport Physiology 101. This would be the ruminal content side. So this would be inside the rumen. This would be what's exposed to the blood. And this is just a diagrammatic characterization of the rumen epithelia. Okay, so you can think of that as the rumen wall as a whole. So when bacteria are digesting carbohydrates, they will be producing short-chain fatty acids. Do you call them short-chain fatty acids or volatile fatty acids? VFAs, okay? So if I say short-chain fatty acids, just assume it's exactly the same as VFA, okay? So short-chain fatty acids are gonna be produced. The saliva is gonna provide bicarbonate. And that bicarbonate is going to react with protons that are sometimes associated with those VFA. Okay, so the bicarbonate reacts with that proton, produces water and CO2. So that water then can participate in helping move digesta throughout the gastrointestinal tract. And this CO2 is removed through eructation. Okay, and by removing that CO2, we make sure that that bicarbonate and that proton continue to react through that carbonic anhydrase reaction. Okay, so that's how the rumen is going to be buffered, because this H, this proton, that's the acid. Okay, we also will have short chain fatty acids in the undissociated form or the complex form. And probably when you went through school, you were taught that short chain fatty acids are absorbed in this form and they cross all the way through to blood, or maybe the rumen might metabolize some of them. But I'm gonna tell you that's wrong. And I was taught the wrong theory as well, okay? So I'm gonna give you an updated theory and it's gonna provide a lot more knowledge. The other thing we need to think about is pHs, and because pHs are important because it affects the relative proportion that would be in the charged state, the anion, or the undissociated state, which is lipophilic and able to actually passive diffuse across membranes, okay? So in the rumen, the pH is normally 5 to 7. And so if we use the Henderson-Hasselbalch equation, we can say that, you know, 67 to 100% of the VFA would actually be in the anion form. So a form that cannot passively diffuse across that tissue. Okay, so that puts a mathematical and a biological constraint against the previous understanding of VFA absorption. So what happens is we still have some VFA in that undissociated form, and it can absorb across the first membrane barrier of the epithelium, but because the pH in the cell has to be around 7.4, that short chain fatty acid has to dissociate. So it separates from the proton, leaving an anion and a proton. And if the cell would not take care of this proton, the intracellular pH would drop. It might kill the cell. And if we kill the cells lining the gastrointestinal tract, we're probably going to kill the cow. Okay, we increase risk for bacteria to cross from the gut into the blood. Okay. Those short chain fatty acids are also going to be metabolized. Okay, and some of the end products are ketones and lactic acid. So we often think about beta-hydroxybutyric acid in transition dairy cows. Well, guess what? The first site of ketone production is in the rumen, and this is not a negative situation for ketone production. Yep?
Yeah, forgive my ignorance, but when you measure rumen pH, do you look at the variation within the rumen and especially measure the pH adjacent to the absorptive tissues?
Perfect. There is enormous variation in pH in the rumen. When we measure it, we typically measure pH in the ventral sac, so the bottom of the rumen, because that's the largest area that's exposed to that absorptive surface area. That is different than the microclimate that might occur at the rumen epithelium, but the Germans have measured that microclimate, and it's not the way that we thought it was. We used to think it was acidic. It's actually a basic microclimate. So that challenges the idea of passive diffusion even more. I'll pay you for asking that question after, okay? Okay, so we still have some passive diffusion, but the biological constraints around that passive diffusion are clear. We also know that that cell must manage that proton. So if the proton comes in through passive diffusion and then is excreted back into the rumen, we have a recycling, but we don't have any removal of proton. So that means pH won't change, right? Because the acid load in the rumen has stayed the same. Okay? What's most important is there's another mechanism that's been discovered about 12, 13 years ago now, where short-chain fatty acids, or VFA, are absorbed in the anion form, and as they're being absorbed, bicarbonate is secreted into the rumen by the rumen epithelium. Okay, and this is a really clever approach, because not only are the cows absorbing the most prominent energy substrate for productive purposes, but in the same time, they're secreting the most prominent buffer into the rumen ecosystem. Okay, so this is the true win-win. You absorb energy and you buffer the rumen at the same time. Okay, and this transporter is located throughout the gastrointestinal tract. You and I have these transporters all over our epithelia as well. Okay, it's in your respiratory tract, except other than using short-chain fatty acid, it transports chloride. Okay. So it's a very common transporter, a really important mechanism to help maintain rumen pH, and it's pulling that bicarbonate from arterial sources using a number of different transporter systems. Okay, so circulating bicarbonate is providing the bicarbonate that the cells are going to use to absorb short-chain fatty acids, absorb energy, and help buffer the rumen. So a really important concept for stabilization of pH. There's one more mechanism we know, and I think it's relevant here because you probably deal with some high nitrate pastures, and if we increase nitrate concentration in the rumen, we can decrease the rate of VFA absorption. We don't know much about the transporter, but we do know the impact is greater for acetic acid than it is for butyric acid. Okay, and we expect it's intermediate for propionate. So I just bring that up as a point of caution. It's a small change. It's maybe 20% or 10% of the total VFA transport, probably more like 10% of the total, okay? But it is relevant to New Zealand-type conditions. So if we use that information and we start modeling the response and we calculate the amount of bicarbonate coming from saliva or the amount of bicarbonate coming from the rumen epithelium, this would be a high forage diet or a high grain diet, and you can see in both cases there is actually quantitatively more bicarbonate coming into the rumen from the rumen wall than there is coming into the rumen from saliva. And that gets to be greater as we start moving to dietary situations that lead to high fermentability, faster eating rates, and lower chewing rates, okay? So in our system, that's a high grain diet, and we know that cattle eat faster and ruminate less. So if I was going to replace the activity of the microbes, I could go to a chemical supplier and I could purchase about almost two and a half liters of pure acetic acid, 2.2 liters of propionic acid, and almost a liter of butyric acid, and that would be replacing just the fermentation output that the microbes are producing from a major VFA standpoint. And then I'd also have to go buy over 2 kilos of bicarbonate, dump that in the rumen to replace what the epithelium produces, as it's absorbing these short-chain fatty acids. Okay? I'd also need to go buy another kilo and a half and replace saliva. Okay, so we're talking about massive quantities of bicarbonate that those cows are producing on a daily basis. So let's put this in the big picture, right? We were in the weeds pretty deep. Saliva is going to come into the rumen bringing bicarbonate. That still happens, and that's still important, okay? We also know that those short-chain fatty acids are going to be absorbed in two forms. The latter form here is bringing saliva, bringing bicarbonate into the rumen in quantities that are excess or equal or excess of what saliva brings in, okay? Short-chain fatty acids can also pass out of the rumen, and we need to recognize all those buffering mechanisms work in concert to help regulate that rumen pH, okay? So what we're going to start focusing on now is how do we actually understand factors that are influencing the ability primarily for that VFA absorption, because we want to promote it to deliver energy and buffer the rumen simultaneously. Okay, so one of the approaches we use is something called the temporary isolated and washed reticulorumen procedure. So we have a rumen cannulated animal, in this case it's a steer, but we do this in dairy cattle as well. We completely evacuate the digesta out of the rumen, and then we wash it 5 to 6 times. We insert a device into the omasum, so that's the port that digesta would flow out of the rumen. So we put a balloon there so nothing can flow out. We pass a tube through the nostril, it comes out through the esophagus, and then we use that to bring in an esophageal collection device. And so that's another occluding device preventing saliva from coming into the rumen. We can measure the quantity of saliva produced because we have a way to isolate and separate it. Then we put in a sampling device and a mixing device. We put in a buffer with a known volume and a known chemical composition. And by taking samples of that buffer over time, we can measure nutrient disappearance or nutrient appearance. So using this approach, I can measure the rates of VFA absorption occurring in a cow multiple times at different stages or with different treatments. So this is a story that happens with rumen acidosis. Okay, this is a study where this is a high-grain diet. We induced rumen acidosis. So first we measured the response prior to induction. We induced rumen acidosis and we measured VFA absorption 2 days later. And then we measured it again 7 days later. And I'm going to be a little liberal because you can see there's not true mean separation. But I'm going to make the argument that absorption decreases for acetate, propionate, and butyrate, the major VFA, in response to rumen acidosis. Okay, so rumen acidosis is decreasing the absorptive capacity of the rumen. A week later, everything has returned back to normal. Okay, so the animal has recovered and has returned back to normal function. Correspondingly, we see a change in saliva production. So when rumen absorption goes down, saliva production is going up. And I think that's a very clever strategy and highlights plasticity in how the rumen can be buffered. If we have low pH and the cow was just absorbing all those acids, it might overwhelm the ability to buffer the cells and it might induce a metabolic acidosis. I don't think the cow is looking for maximal milk fat production. The cow wants to see tomorrow, okay? So I think the cow shuts down absorption, which reduces the bicarbonate coming from the rumen, and it says, I'm gonna divert more bicarbonate through saliva to help regulate that rumen pH, okay? Yep.
Another one about saliva. Do you know much about saliva production when animals are fed a chewed up TMR diet versus a roughage like grasses and stuff? And something I hadn't thought of before, do they produce much saliva when they're not eating or ruminating?
So two questions. Do we know much about saliva composition? The first one, no, we don't. We really don't understand saliva production characteristics or composition much. There are two different types of saliva that are generated. There's more of a mucus saliva and more of a bicarbonate-rich saliva. There are old textbooks that characterize that salivary contribution. So our knowledge goes back to the 60s, but it ends in the 70s. So it's been a huge gap. We have some of the most recent papers characterizing saliva production. In fact, we have one that's in review right now. So hopefully it will get accepted. Yeah. So your knowledge is maximal in this case, right? Do they produce when they're not eating? Absolutely. There is a resting salivation rate, but we assume cows always have the same resting salivation rate. And we assume saliva production during eating and rumination is equal. And those probably are not appropriate assumptions, but what else do we do? Right? You have to start somewhere. So there's limitations with our knowledge, but at least we have a place to start and move forward with. Okay? So we're going to get back to our transition cows and keep this rumen function in the back of your mind. I've been arguing that these cows drop feed intake. So we started running studies where we purposely reduced feed intake by restricting the amount that we fed to cattle. I understand there might be challenges with pasture access here, which, you know, take that frame of thought where pasture access might actually limit dry matter intake. So in this case, we measured their voluntary dry matter intake. We restricted them to 75, 50, or 25%. And we measured responses during baseline and during that feed restriction, and then we also measured the recovery response as we allowed them full access to the same diet. Not surprising, when we put them through feed restriction, there's less substrate going into the rumen, and so the microbes have less to ferment, and so we see lower short-chain fatty acid concentrations in the rumen. Right? This is not groundbreaking. This just helps confirm that we are doing what we think we are doing. Okay. Then when we use that washed rumen technique and we measure the ability for VFA absorption, we can see again, I'm going to be a little bit liberal, and you can see why I implement repeatability in this, but I'm going to argue this is a reduction in short chain fatty acid absorption rate, and I'm going to argue it's dose dependent. So the more those cattle go off feed, the greater the reduction in VFA absorption potential there is. And because of the technique we used, it's not because there was less VFA in the rumen. Because we introduce a buffer that has the same volume and the same VFA. So this is actually absorptive potential. Okay, so it would be amplified when there's less VFA. Okay, this is another study, high forage or moderate forage diet. You can see our feed restriction, statistical reduction in VFA absorption. Different experiment, different conditions, similar response. I think this is biology. Okay? Why do we think that happens? I want to draw your attention to the p-values here on the right. So you'll notice these are all significant. And then we're just going to look at the bottom line, and we're going to compare the control and our low feed intake challenge group. So this is the surface area of the rumen epithelium after 5 days of low feed intake, and the low feed intake was 25% of their voluntary dry matter intake. There are a lot of transition dairy cattle that only consume 25% of their expected intake. And we can see that ruminal papillae surface area has decreased by over 50% in 5 days. How long does it take to maximize papillae surface area? I'm not asking you, Tony. Okay, so this is old work coming out of Germany where the steam-up diet was really promoted. Okay, and part of the reason it was promoted is they saw when cattle went to a low-energy diet during the dry-off, there was a reduction in papillae surface area. So a reduction in potential absorption. And then when they transitioned them to a high-energy diet, and in this study they did that actually 2 weeks prior to calving, they saw an increase in papillae absorption or papillae surface area. So this data was a very strong part of the stimulus to start steaming cows up. And they showed that those adapted cattle, using the same technique that we use, were able to clear VFA from the rumen faster than the non-adapted cattle. OK, Okay, so these would be adapted cattle, these would be non-adapted cattle, but they were balanced for stage of production. Okay, so they showed that greater papillae surface area leads to greater capability to absorb VFA. Again, that's important from a regulation of rumen pH, but also meeting energy supply. Okay, I'm going to argue throughout this that we need to think beyond the rumen, and this is work that Lance Baumgard's group had done. We're just going to focus on the white or black bars and the white bars. So low feed intake reduces the width of the intestinal villi, so the absorptive structures in the jejunum, reduces crypt depth, reduces ileal width, and reduces ileal crypt depth. Okay, so not only does low feed intake reduce papillae surface area, but we're seeing a reduction in intestinal absorptive surface area. And then we ran this study with sheep, where we imposed 5 days or 10 days of low feed intake. And again, I'm going to be a little liberal with p-values, but you can see a reduction in the weight of the rumen, a reduction in the weight of the abomasum, duodenum, jejunum, ileum, colon, and probably more striking, a reduction in the weight of the liver. And that liver weight was reduced within 5 days. Does the liver matter for transition dairy cows? Absolutely, right? That's the site of gluconeogenesis, has to process fat that is being mobilized. I'm not sure we want to see a reduction in liver weight driven by low feed intake events. Okay, so I think again, I'll come to you right away. I think again to those cows that struggle during the transition phase that go off feed and probably are facing other challenges in the gastrointestinal tract that we don't conventionally think about. So this is about 50% silage, 50% barley grain with mineral and vitamin and a small protein supplement included. So a moderate forage diet that would be reflective of conventional dairy systems in North America. Okay. So I'm going to start tying in other concepts. This is the recovery phase after we impose that feed restriction event. Okay, so this is a high forage diet and our moderate forage diet, which is again about 50% forage. And just imposing that feed restriction event actually caused those cows that were on that moderate forage diet or moderately fermentable diet to experience ruminal acidosis. Now, what I want you to recognize is they experienced ruminal acidosis with relatively low feed intake. Okay, so now we have a situation where we have both low intake and low ruminal pH. And we think this is driven by all those changes that I talked about in the previous slides with reduced absorptive surface area and reduced absorptive capacity. Yep?
Were these animals, were they pre-calving transition?
These are actually beef heifers. So not pregnant, no social changes, no dietary changes. It was just a change in feed allocation that we were looking at. So we're trying to eliminate some of the confounding factors that would influence this data. Yeah. Okay. Now, when we induce rumen pH or cattle go through rumen pH reductions, it's not just the rumen that's affected. And this is an induction study where we have a pretty substantial reduction in ruminal pH. But we also have a reduction in pH happening in the hindgut. Okay, and so remember the gastrointestinal tract is outside of the animal, and it's in the animal's advantage to keep external things external when you can't manage the absorption or removal of those acids. Okay, so I think we need to think a bit more about what's happening post-ruminally and recognize there's a very large part of the gastrointestinal tract there. Not only is the gastrointestinal tract large postruminally, the structure is very different. So from the mouth until the end of the omasum, the structure is quite complex with multiple cell layers and an outside keratinized layer that helps provide protection against abrasive forces. Okay, but there is no antimicrobial secretion that we're aware of that occurs in that pre-gastric area. Once we get to the gastric stomach, the abomasum, all the way out to the rectum, we're dealing with a single epithelial cell layer. So their ability, or the way that they protect from invading pathogens or endotoxins, is by secreting antimicrobial peptides and immunoglobulins, by secreting quite large amounts of viscous mucus, and then they also have anchoring proteins between those cells that help regulate that barrier. So if you were a microbe, and your goal was to survive and colonize the liver of a dairy cow, which epithelial structure would you choose to cross? Okay, we've historically argued this is happening here, but I think we need to challenge some of those concepts. Okay, so we used our ex vivo approach to characterize permeability responses of the gastrointestinal tract epithelia. So this is the amount that a non-transported molecule can cross. So higher bars simply mean the gut is more leaky in that region. And what you can clearly see is the rumen and the omasum are quite tight. Not a lot leaks across in healthy animals. And it gets to be quite tight as we move more distally in the gastrointestinal tract. And that fits the common theory of gastrointestinal permeability, where areas of high microbial abundance should also have tight tissues, right? There's more risk for pathogens or endotoxins to cross into the bloodstream, so the epithelia adapts by being tighter. But we have this intestinal region that can be quite leaky at times and is a very large portion of the gastrointestinal tract in terms of surface area and is also associated with a pile of lymphatic tissue. Okay, so in fact, most of the immune system is in the gut. Okay, and it's in these regions of the gut. So we wanted to be able to do this in live animals, so we developed another technique that, or modified a technique. We use cobalt EDTA, and we infuse that cobalt EDTA into the abomasum. So it's going past the rumen, so any appearance of cobalt EDTA we can say is post-ruminal permeability. And then we put chromium EDTA in the rumen. We collect urine over time, and you can see the urine has a purple pigment that shows that the cobalt EDTA and the chromium EDTA is coming out in urine. Those should not be absorbed across the gastrointestinal tract, and as scientists, we often use those markers as digestibility markers, because about 97-98% of them will be excreted in feces. So we're really looking at the small portion that isn't excreted in feces with a large pulse dose. Okay? So we ran a study. This was on heat-stressed dairy cattle, and I just show you this to emphasize the importance of the intestine. When we look across treatments, we can affect the permeability of the intestine, in this case by providing a relatively insoluble buffer. The point is 55 to 82% of the permeability occurred post-ruminally. Okay? So we can't forget the intestine. And I think there's growing emphasis to start looking at nutritional processes that might help enhance intestinal function. Okay? Remember, that structure is very different, and we have to get products past the rumen, past the abomasum, to induce potential effects in those intestinal regions. Okay? Why is that important? This is, LPS is one endotoxin that's commonly found in the gastrointestinal tract. We measured LPS concentrations throughout the gastrointestinal tract, and we found quite high concentrations in the ileum. Okay, so the site where fermentation is starting to initiate prior to the large intestine. Ileum is loaded with Peyer's patches and lymphatic tissue. Okay, so we think the ileum probably plays a key role in the pathology of rumen acidosis and the inflammation that's driven from that. And that's really helped develop some of the models, and this is a relatively recent model that was published in a review paper, where we can have all these ruminal changes that are occurring, compromised epithelial barrier, so you can see epithelial damage. We also have hindgut issues, and those factors are driving an inflammatory response, and it's my personal opinion that I don't really care about rumen pH unless we start seeing evidence of inflammation, and that's when we start to really see reductions or negative outcomes associated with ruminal acidosis. Yep.
One of the questions I was going to ask earlier was, can you tell me a bit more about the inflammation? Do you see it, or is it just a measure, or if it's affecting specific organs, liver?
Yep.
Tell me about it, please.
Perfect question. So we can measure inflammation locally within different tissue regions. So we can either induce it and show that the metabolic machinery to induce a localized immune response is present. We have that data available. That localized immune response also recruits macrophages and induces a systemic response. So we can measure it both locally. You can visually see it. When we do terminal experiments, you can see evidence of edema or redness in the gastrointestinal tract. Yeah, you can see that in the intestine. You can also see it evidence in the rumen. We can also use blood markers, so indicators of inflammation, but they are very time dependent. So when you collect the sample has a big influence on the concentrations observed. Okay, so let's get back to the broader concept of our transition cows. I want to emphasize again that this change in dry matter intake is something that I think is really underappreciated. Okay, so this is a study where they were trying to separate out differences between tolerant and susceptible cows to ruminal acidosis. So same management, same herd, common close-up diet, common early lactation diet. I'm showing you the mean pH changes and how they differ between the susceptible and the tolerant. And when they looked back at their models, one of the factors that helped identify those tolerant cows was higher dry matter intake prior to parturition. Okay, so they didn't decrease dry matter intake to the same extent as parturition was approaching. Okay, you can see the same data. In this case, we're just looking at time that pH is below 5.8. Here's another study. In this case, they fed a high concentrate diet or a low starch diet prior to parturition. And then they challenged those cows with rumen acidosis induction study or induction challenges. And you can see the cattle that were fed high starch prior to parturition had higher risk. The cattle that were fed high starch prior to parturition also had higher risk of ruminal acidosis on day 7 of lactation and of day 21. So how we adapt those cows during the pre-fresh phase probably is impacting the risk for ruminal acidosis postpartum. And I think that ties nice into the model that I showed, where higher starch diets cause a greater reduction in dry matter intake. This reduction in dry matter intake decreases gastrointestinal tract capability and function. And as those cows start increasing their dry matter intake, it increases risk for subclinical ruminal acidosis. Okay? Yep.
I'm a little bit confused, sorry. When you said that you have a higher risk if they eat less,
yep.
Then, it's like before you said that those cows that were eating more had the ones that you could identify that were more tolerant had a lower pH drop, right?
Yep.
So if they're being fed more grain, and you just showed that being fed more grain is actually,
so in this case, dry matter intake is similar, okay, but they're getting more starch, because these are TMR-based feeding systems, they're getting more starch or less starch without changes in dry matter intake.
Right, and the tolerant cows that you were seeing
before. These? Yeah, so they did not drop dry matter intake as much as parturition was approaching. So I think it's the reduction in dry matter intake followed by an increase in dry matter intake that increases risk for rumen acidosis. So when they go off feed, nobody has rumen acidosis. They have high pH, low VFA concentrations. But when they start to eat again, the microbes can ferment that feed very fast, and the microbes can adapt much faster than the gastrointestinal tract.
So is the delta the one that causes the SARA?
We think it's the drop followed by the increase. Yeah, and so that's why in this model, we have the reduction in dry matter intake followed by increasing dry matter intake that increases risk for subclinical ruminal acidosis. Yeah, I'll close up right here. So this is my theory, or the message that I hope I've conveyed to you. Its transition cows appear to be at relatively high risk for ruminal pH depressions during early lactation. Strategies to actually increase absorptive surface area may work against us. And I showed you a number of evidence that steam-up diets might actually make the situation worse, probably because of a greater reduction in dry matter intake as parturition approaches, and because of that rapid reduction in absorptive surface area with short-term reductions in feed intake. Okay? We think that it's really this transient exposure to low feed intake prior to increased dry matter intake that increases risk, and that metabolic disorders or infectious disease drives a reduction in dry matter intake, and by doing so, increases subsequent risk for rumen acidosis. With that, I hope we have maybe a minute or two or more for questions. I have to thank the sponsors for our research program. We are beggars as researchers. We need people to fund the work by selling our ideas, so I appreciate the industry and government support. And I have students that are still working at home, so I can come to beautiful countries like New Zealand, share what we learn, but I can't dismiss that they are the workhorse behind the information that we generate.
Round of applause. So thank you very much. I think there's some very, there's a huge body of work there. I think we can all acknowledge the research that has gone into that talk, but also some very applicable and relevant outcomes for our New Zealand dairy industry. And I've got in the back of my mind this wet weather we've had in a lot of the country and standoff conditions with our cows and the impact that that could be having. So we've got some questions. We've got these post-it notes, so I've got a whole list of questions that I'll save for the panel discussion. But if you also have some sitting in the back of your mind, you do write them down in the post-it notes. We'll collect them up. We'll try and group them and have a really cool discussion at the end. But I know, Brian, you had your hand up. We'll give you one question, and then we'll head into morning tea.
Yeah, so I think it's a realistic challenge where maybe the models we're using are higher starch prior to induction. We've done some pretty low starch induction studies, so not as low as 4 or 5%. But I can induce rumen acidosis on a high forage diet by exposing them to feed intake limitations. So it's not just starch. Starch makes it easier for me. But your forages are high in sugar, and I think Ian's going to come talk about risks of sugar. So it's not that you don't have fermentable forages. You have highly fermentable forages, right? We don't have such fermentable forages, so we have to cheat the system by bringing in starch. So I think we really need to think more about fermentation potential in addition to the type of substrate that's being fermented. Sugars can be, in some cases, quite a bit worse than starch. Correct. If they are in a pro-inflammatory state, or we create a leaky gut situation that allows for antigens or endotoxins or bacteria to breach that gastrointestinal tract barrier, that really causes a marked increase in the severity of the outcome.
Excellent. Thank you, Professor Greg. We really appreciate your talk, and we look forward to the panel discussion later. So we're breaking into morning tea now. We're back at 11 a.m.
What spring is like on Jupiter and Mars. In other words, hold my hand. In other words,